Hey, good evening, everybody. We're going to start a little early. Why don't you greet somebody around you, step out from where you are for the next couple of minutes. If you want to just stay in your seat, shake somebody's hand, that's fine. Tell somebody hello, turn and smile at someone. It's good to see all of you tonight. Why don't you stand with me? We're going to get started. So glad you're here. Thank you for being here on a Wednesday night. And how about that taste of winter we've been having this week? Hey, it's Easter week, you know. All things are possible. But I think it's supposed to get warmer and nice weather on Friday so far. So continue to pray for that, for worship in the park. A reminder on that, we're starting at 5:30. And, of course, we'll have food. And we've got the pie truck coming back this year. That's going to be great. We've got, Dean, again, is smoking the meat, and it's going to be amazing because he's awesome, and we're going to have pork nachos, I think is what it is, and different food options there for you. So that's going to be a great time. Here's what we need you to do, though. You need to bring some type of a chair for you to sit in for worship at the park, okay? There are no seats out there on the lawn, so or a blanket, whatever you want to do. But bring that with you on that night. It's going to be a great night. That's going to be a great time. Anybody talk to someone that they said they'd come with you? Anybody? Yeah, awesome. I think most of our cards you took with you Sunday, so thank you for grabbing a card and taking it to pass out. It's going to be a great time. And then Easter on Sunday, which is going to be a great day. How many of you believe that? It's going to be a great Sunday. Great Sunday. Three services, and this is going to be a great day. 8:30, 10 o'clock, and then 11:30. And so if you have not, we sent out a survey that we need your help with. If you have not filled that survey out, we need you to go in there and please do that, because we want to try to balance those services, and we might be asking some of you to maybe switch to another service. We're trying to figure out how those three services are going to look, because here's the deal. I know there will be many, many guests here. We always have many guests. But it would be really bad if we have only guests in third service and none of our church people. And y'all aren't laughing, and I'm actually not laughing either, because it's real bad for me to have to be up here and preach and try to preach that third service without some help from the body of Christ. So please fill out that survey and help us out. That gives us a good idea of what we're looking at if you haven't done that already. But it's going to be a great weekend. It's a full weekend, and I'm excited about it. So thank you so very much for already participating, being involved in that, and for your help for signing up to volunteer Friday night. Thank you so very much for that. Why don't we pray, and let's get started on our last lesson of our Gifted Church series, which I'm excited about. Hope you are as well. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your blessings. Thank you for all that you are to us. I thank you, Lord, for this privilege to know you, to serve you, to be a part of the body of Christ. I thank you for each and every person in this room tonight and that is online watching, that's connected to the church body. I pray your strength. I pray your healing. I pray, God, your uplifting and encouragement to each and every person. Help our hearts to be open and receptive to that which you would speak to us tonight and instruct us through your word. In Jesus' name we pray. And let the church say amen. God bless you. You may be seated. All right. So the Gifted Church, a gifted church, is the gifts of the Spirit we've been talking about. And last week, we covered the power gifts, faith, gifts of healing, working of miracles. The week before that, the revelation gifts, the word of wisdom, word of knowledge, discerning of spirits. And so tonight we're going to cover this final category of prophecy, tongues, and the interpretation of tongues. And let me just remind you of something I've said each week, is that in order to experience the operation of the gifts of the Spirit, you need to have the Spirit. You need to be filled with the Spirit. It's important to have it, to have the gift of the Spirit operating through your life. If it does not glorify Jesus and edify the church, then it is not of Jesus. If it glorifies the flesh, it is not of Jesus. We do not operate in the gifts of the Spirit, rather, and we are not in control of His Spirit. Rather, we are in control of our spirit, and God operates the gifts through us by the power of His Spirit. And those who are using the gifts of the Spirit, they're not perfect. Okay, the operation of the gifts are, however, a reflection of God's nature and character, not ours. And a reminder, the gifts require faith. For the gifts to be working in our lives and through our lives, it does require faith. These signs shall follow them that believe. Amen? Anybody glad to be here tonight? All right, just making sure. I hope so. Because it's going to be a tough night on me if not. But I'm glad you're here. It's good to see you. Okay, let's jump in here. Let's talk about these last three gifts of the Spirit. Let's talk about the vocal gifts. Let's first talk about prophecy, okay? There is a difference between the ministry of the prophet, which is the fivefold ministry, okay, and the person who has the gift of prophecy, all right? Prophets have the gift of prophecy, but not all who have the gift of prophecy are prophets. Okay? So if they're part of the fivefold ministry, it's a calling. They're called to a prophetic ministry. It's a calling of God, and they will continually operate in the prophetic. But in the body of Christ, there are people who God can give a gift of prophecy, and they be used in that gift. Okay, so that's the difference. One is an office of permanent ministry, calling, a prophet who is a spokesperson for God. The other is a spiritual gift that operates in accordance with the will of God at the time and place of His choosing. Okay, let's talk about the gift of prophecy. This is a spiritual gift that is given through the believer, but the believer is not the gift. Prophecy is the gift, okay? There are some people who are used in some of these gifts that I've been teaching about who think they're the gift to the church, all right? The individual is not the gift to the church. However, the gift of God working through them is that gift, and we're thankful for that, and we need that, okay? The gift of prophecy, it is a brief supernatural manifestation in and through that individual. whereby the believer communicates in an understood language a message directly from God. Paul specifies three purposes for prophecy: edification, which is building up and strengthening; exhortation, which is encouragement; and then comfort, which is lifting up one who is troubled. Now, I need to say this. Genuine prophecy is not for the purpose of discouraging or condemning. Okay? It may encourage to repent of sin and turn to God, but it will be in a spirit of edification, exhortation, and comfort. Okay? Let's keep going here, and I'm going to hit on that some more as we move along, but let's keep going and talk about the gift of tongues. There is a difference between speaking in tongues as the initial sign of receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the gift of tongues as a spiritual gift through which God speaks to the church when combined with the gift of the interpretation of tongues. So first, speaking in tongues is the initial sign that accompanies the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The classic examples are the Jewish believers on the day of Pentecost, the Gentile household of Cornelius, and the disciples of John at Ephesus. That's in Acts 2, 1 through 4, Acts 10, 44 through 48, and Acts 19, 1 through 6. So we see the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is being born again of the Spirit. We see the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is the promise of the Father. And we see the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is exemplified being the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, I do want to pause right here and remind you, we are going to provide these notes for you, okay? After this night, we're going to combine all of these and put it in a syllabus form and make those available to you sometime next week. Is that good? All right. But if you're a note taker, I'm sorry. I know I move pretty quickly through this just so I can get it in. Okay, so let's keep going. Scripture tells us about this initial sign of the Spirit. In John 3, Jesus said, "You must be born again of water and of the Spirit," and that there would be a sound associated with that experience. John 7 says, "When you receive the Holy Spirit, there would be an outward flow or an emotional expression like rivers of living water flowing out of you." Luke 24 talks about the promise of the Father and receiving power from on high. Acts chapter 1 talks about you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit and receive power. Okay? Now, I could go through Acts 2, 4, Acts 10, 45 through 46, Acts 19, 5 through 6, Acts 2, 38 and 39. But for the sake of time, I will just reference those and you can go study those later. But everyone must and everyone can be filled with the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit. That is the initial supernatural sign of receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit, is speaking in tongues. Strictly speaking, we should not employ the term gift of tongues for this first use. It is rather a sign that accompanies the gift of the Holy Spirit in Acts 2:38. The gift of the Holy Spirit is for all believers, according to John 7, 38 through 39, Acts 2, 38 through 39, Acts 11, 15 through 17. And by contrast, not everyone will exercise the gift of tongues for the edification of the body, but everyone can be filled with the promised gift from God, His Spirit, okay? So not everyone will exercise the gift of tongues for edification according to 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 10 and 30. So just as God grants all believers wisdom, knowledge, and faith, or a portion of that, so speaking in tongues is for all believers according to Mark 16, 17. Yet in each case, there is a spiritual gift that goes beyond the everyday experience of all Christians and is used for special moments of need or benefit. The word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, the gift of faith, and also the gift of tongues. It's like a next step for believers, okay? Some people deny the evidentiary role of tongues and further deny that everyone should seek the baptism of the Holy Spirit with this accompanying sign. They usually cite statements in 1 Corinthians 12 through 14, which indicate that not everyone will speak in tongues or that speaking in tongues must be regulated in certain ways. A comparison of Acts and 1 Corinthians quickly reveals, however, that they are confusing the uses of tongues. All right? You see, 1 Corinthians was written to Spirit-filled believers. That's the big, big contrast and difference there that many, many, many do not see or they miss. Context matters in Scripture. So 1 Corinthians was written to Spirit-filled believers. They had all been baptized with the Holy Spirit and had all spoken in tongues at least once. And you can see that in 1 Corinthians 6, 11, 19, 1 Corinthians 12, 13, and Acts 10, 44 through 46. They obviously understood Paul's letter from that perspective that he's writing here. He did not teach that some of them would never speak in tongues, but he explained that not everyone would exercise the public gift of tongues in the life of the congregation who he was addressing, the body of Christ, and when some did, they should follow certain guidelines. Okay? On the day of Pentecost, 120 believers spoke in tongues at the same time when they received the Holy Spirit in Acts 1:15, Acts 2, 1 through 4. And likewise, in Acts 10, the entire household of Cornelius spoke in tongues together. And in Acts 19, 12 disciples at Ephesus spoke in tongues together. Yet 1 Corinthians 14, 27 says that in a public worship service, believers should take turns speaking in tongues to the congregation, and only two or three people should give such messages. In the accounts in Acts, now follow me, in the accounts in Acts, no one interpreted the tongues or even tried to do so. The 120, you don't see that happening. They were just filled with the Spirit of the Holy Ghost, okay? If someone speaks in tongues in a this contrast, however, forces us to one of two conclusions. Either the apostolic church did not follow the inspired instructions of the Apostle Paul regarding tongues, or the use of tongues in Acts is different from the use of tongues in 1 Corinthians. So you got one or the other. Either the apostolic church did not follow the inspired instructions of the Apostle Paul regarding tongues, or the use of tongues in Acts 2 or in Acts is different from the use of tongues in 1 Corinthians. The former alternative is invalid, for it would undercut the unity of the church and the inspiration and authority of Scripture. So clearly then, Acts and 1 Corinthians deal with two different situations. Acts records the role of tongues in the conversion of individuals, while 1 Corinthians provides guidelines for the continuing use of tongues in public meetings and gatherings or church services. Okay, so let's talk about the gift of tongues. Let's talk about the gift of tongues as one of the nine spiritual gifts now that we've seen that distinction. Trying to bring clarity to that because there is a lot of confusion surrounding it. But all of the gifts are spoken of within the context of what we would term a church service in 1 Corinthians. Okay, he is speaking to the church, speaking to believers. And he's speaking about when they're gathered together, basically when they're having church. So when the church comes together as a body is what he's referring to. There are certain guidelines and instruction that we must submit to when we are together as the church and the gifts of the Spirit are in operation. The gift of tongues is specifically when a believer is inspired by the Spirit of God to speak a message in an unknown tongue, not understood by the one speaking, because God is going to use the next gift, the gift of the interpretation of tongues, in order to deliver that message to the church. Okay? And when that interpretation comes, it will be in the language understood by the people. So let's talk about that interpretation of tongues. The gift of the interpretation of tongues is the ability given by the Holy Spirit for a believer to speak in a known tongue and understood tongue and language the meaning of the words previously spoken in an unknown language or tongue. All right? Sometimes it is the same person who speaks in tongues and then interprets. At other times, God may use one person to speak in tongues and another person to interpret. The Greek word translated interpretation here is hermeneia, from which we get the English word hermeneutics, meaning principles of interpretation. Okay? To interpret means to explain the meaning of or to translate verbally or orally. It means to give the sense of something, but it does not necessarily mean to translate word for word. Okay? Note this. This is not the gift of the translation of tongues. The person interpreting does not understand the words spoken in tongues. God is giving them the interpretation or the meaning of those words. It's inspired by God. It is not a word for word translation. The message in tongues may be short and the interpretation long. And I've seen this happen before, and I've literally watched people afterwards go, because the tongue can be long and the interpretation be Jesus loves you. You know? Because, I'm having some fun with that, but because German, Russian, other languages, if that tongue is in one of those dialects or languages, it may take more words, okay, to say what's needing to be said. And so the English translation may be shorter or it may be longer, depending on whatever that tongue was. Here's what the person speaking will use: their own words, their own vocabulary, their own personality and accent. Okay? They don't turn into another person. Right? It's not like they start, you know, speaking with this. Like, I'm Southern, y'all, okay? If I'm given a interpretation of tongues, you're still going to hear a Southern accent. I'm not going to turn into some Australian, all right? I mean, I wish I could, because they have a really cool dialect and accent. But that's not what happened, okay? And neither should it happen from the person that is given that interpretation. The Holy Spirit does not speak King James English. However, now hear this. This is a true thing. However, because some are so familiar with the KJV, they're very studied in the King James Version of the Bible. They've studied it, they've memorized it, and even associate the voice of God with it, that it's okay if they break out in some KJV. It does not discredit the message if they use a thee or a thou instead of a he or, right? Okay. Different people receive an interpretation in different ways. Some initially receive an idea, a word, a phrase, or even a picture as they begin to speak in faith. God continues to impart his message and the words flow. Others explain that an interpretation comes much like speaking in tongues with the cooperation of their tongue, but without the advanced understanding of their mind. They hear and comprehend the message along with everyone else as it's happening. Some people say it's like a scroll, literally, or a teleprompter, where they're just, God is showing them what to say. So there's no set way. Everybody is different, and God uses people in different ways in this gift. But we can define the interpretation of tongues as the gift of a supernatural ability to translate or explain the meaning of a public utterance in tongues in the church. Okay, now, 1 Corinthians 12, through 14. If you have your Bible, you can grab it, or your mobile device, or you can follow along with the screen. That's fine, but I think it's great if you can actually see some of this. Let's break it down. Let's break down Paul's instruction to the Corinthians, specifically concerning prophecy and tongues. Remember, these gifts are spoken of within the context of a church service, okay? When the church comes together as a body. 1 Corinthians 12, 27 through 30. This is the ESV, English Standard Version. It says, "Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helping, administrating, and various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret?" Paul, this is where people confuse that initial experience of being filled with the Spirit of God and the gift of tongues. They say, well, there it says, do all speak with tongues? So not everybody going to speak in tongues. Okay, Paul is specifically talking here about spiritual gifts. He's speaking to the church. Some have used this verse to say that not everyone will speak in tongues when they receive the Holy Spirit. That is not what Paul is talking about. As I stated before, he was speaking to the church full of people that had already been filled with the gift of the Spirit and had spoken in tongues. 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 3, "If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned but have not love, I gain nothing." What is that saying? Love must be our motivation when it comes to the operation of the gifts of the Spirit. Not pride, not look at me and how spiritual I am, not personal gain or a power struggle, you know, somebody else, not finances, not fame, not condemnation, beating people up because they're not saved or because they're not as spiritual as you think they should be. That's not what these are for. It's not what the gifts are for. The spiritual gifts are nothing if they are not in operation from a motivation of a love for God, a love for truth, and a love for people. The spiritual gifts are nothing without that. 1 Corinthians 13, 8 through 10. "Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away." I read this in our first lesson. "As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away." Again, that's been used to say, see, tongues will cease. Yeah, tongues will cease when that which is perfect is come. Okay, that is not the biblical canon. It's when Christ returns for his church. When perfect comes, when the perfect one comes, perfection will come and tongues will not be needed anymore. Prophecies will not be needed anymore. The perfect one will have come back, returned for us, for the church, and those things will not be needed anymore. Remember, these gifts are spoken of within the context of a church service. You're going to hear me say that all night long. When the church comes together as a body is when we're going to see these things in operation. After introducing the spiritual gifts and teaching the importance of unity and love in the exercise of them, 1 Corinthians instructs us as to their proper use in public worship. It provides guidelines to eliminate confusion, to establish order, so that the purpose of the spiritual gifts, to glorify Christ and to edify his body, can be accomplished and fulfilled. Okay, so 1 Corinthians 14. Particularly addresses the three gifts of the utterance, tongues, interpretation of tongues, and prophecy. And because they have the greatest potential for misuse in a church service, we're going to break it down and talk about it even more. All right? 1 Corinthians 14, 1 through 33, 37 through 40, and we're going to skip a few things just because I want to focus specifically on the gifts of the Spirit. But 1 Corinthians 14, pursue love, verse 1, and earnestly desire the spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy. Now, the first half of the sentence puts the two preceding chapters into perspective. We must pursue love first, and having done so, we are to then desire spiritual gifts. All right? Then the verse tells us that prophecy is especially desirable in the church, in public meetings, in public gatherings, in church services. Okay? Let's keep going. For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God, for no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit. On the other hand, the one who prophesies speaks to people for their upbuilding and encouragement and consolation. The one who speaks in a tongue builds up himself, but the one who prophesies builds up the church. Now, I want you all to speak in tongues, he said, but even more to prophesy. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless someone interprets, so that the church may be built up. Who is he addressing? Y'all hadn't got it yet. I might have to keep saying it. He's speaking to the church, the body of Christ, Spirit-filled believers. He's talking to the church here and how to conduct themselves in church. Okay? When they're gathered together. Verse 2 through 5. It contrasts prophecy and tongues, explaining that prophecy is more beneficial, really, in public meetings than tongues, unless there is an interpretation for the latter. Okay? Someone who speaks in tongues speaks to God, while someone who prophesies speaks to others. Speaking in tongues benefits the speaker only, while prophecy benefits the entire congregation. Thus, in a group setting, prophecy is more valuable than tongues alone, is what it's saying. If speaking in tongues is accomplished by interpretation, however, then it has the same value as prophecy, because you're going to understand what's being said or what's happening. Okay? Now, let's keep going. Now, brothers, if I come to you speaking in tongues, how will I benefit you unless I bring you some revelation or knowledge or prophecy or teaching? If even lifeless instruments, such as the flute or the harp, do not give distinct notes, how will anyone know what is played? And if the bugle gives an indistinct sound, who will get ready for battle? So with yourselves, if with your tongue you utter speech that is not intelligible, okay, we're talking about in this public setting, church setting, how will anyone know what is said? For you will be speaking into the air. There are doubtless many different languages in the world, and none is without meaning. But if I do not know the meaning of the language, I will be a foreigner to the speaker, and the speaker a foreigner to me. These verses provide examples of the superiority of an understandable message. A flutist and a harpist must play distinct notes to create a song. And a military trumpeter or a bugler must play distinct notes when issuing commands for battle. Likewise, when someone speaks to the church, he must use understandable speech to communicate, or else he is like a foreigner. That's what that's saying. This discussion holds true both for the supernatural gift of prophecy and for prophecy in the general sense of all anointed speaking, including preaching. Verse 6 uses four words to describe an utterance in a known tongue. They are not necessarily mutually exclusive, but together they cover all types of spiritual speech in the church, whether revealed directly from God, which is revelation, or acquired through the study of God's word, which is knowledge. So it says this in verse 12. So with yourselves, since you are eager for manifestations of the Spirit, strive to excel in building up the church. This sentence, it helps us see the principle of seeking the greatest good for the church. If we truly want to be spiritual, We should think about the needs of others and not just ourselves. We should excel in ministry to the body. So clearly this passage does not describe someone receiving the Holy Spirit or praying individually in the Spirit, but it relates to group worship or a group setting or a service time. And apparently the Corinthian believers were so zealous for spiritual gifts that when they came together, speaking in tongues dominated their corporate worship. That's all you ever heard. They had plenty of other opportunities to speak in tongues for personal edification. However, Paul talks about that. They needed to use their valuable meeting time, though, for something that would edify, build up, strengthen the body. 13, verse 13, therefore, one who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. These verses provide the practical application regarding tongues in a church service. If God moves on an individual to speak to the group in tongues, then they should pray for God to give them the interpretation. In this way, he will be able to bless everyone rather than merely himself. Verse 15, what am I to do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will pray with my mind also. I will sing praise with my spirit, but I will sing with my mind also. Here is the conclusion for the personal use of tongues. It is valuable to pray and sing in tongues, yes. And it is valuable to pray and sing in one's own language, yes. Both are important. Neither should be disparaged or slighted. The implication here is that each have their proper time, though, and place. Okay? Verse 16, otherwise, if you give thanks with your spirit, how can anyone in the position of an outsider say amen to your thanksgiving when he does not know what you are saying? For you may be giving thanks well enough, but the other person is not being built up. I thank God, verse 18, I speak in tongues more than all of you. It's the Apostle Paul, okay? He's like, I do this. I speak in tongues. I pray in tongues. I worship in tongues. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. So take that. All right? But then he says, nevertheless, in church, I would rather speak five words with my mind in order to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. These verses further elaborate on the distinction between the public and private uses of tongues, reiterating the thought of verses 1 through 14. If someone is called upon to pray a representative prayer, it's better to pray in the common language so that all can give informed assent to the prayer offered on their behalf. What if I called on Bishop and said, would you pray over Wednesday night in our lesson tonight, and all he did was pray in tongues? Ain't none of us know, unless somebody gets the interpretation, there ain't none of us going to know what he prayed. Okay? Tongues are very valuable. They're very valuable. There's a place for them. Tongues are very valuable even for personal devotion. Indeed, Paul would not let anyone outdo him in that regard. I speak in tongues more than all of you. Okay, verse 18. Yet in the church, in meetings of believers, a few understandable words are more valuable than many unknown words. That's what he's saying in verse 19. All right? Verse 15 through 16 and verses 18 through 19 are parallel. Verse 15 and verse 18, it's really cool there when you look at that and study it. Both proclaim the value of tongues in private devotion. On the other hand, verse 16 and verse 19 illustrate the superiority of understandable speech in public worship activities. So both are important, both are needed. And it doesn't mean that you can't ever pray in the Spirit in public worship settings, but you should be doing it in private, really, in that moment. If your praying in the Spirit is so loud that you're over here, but over there, they can hear it, that's when it needs an interpretation. Because that is confusing to a guest back there going, what's happening? What are they saying? That's what it's talking about. That's what it's talking about. Now skipping down, looking at verse 21 through 22. In the law it is written, by people of strange tongues and by the lips of foreigners will I speak to this people, and even then they will not listen to me, says the Lord. Thus tongues are a sign, not for believers, but for unbelievers, while prophecy is a sign, not for unbelievers, but for believers. To explain further the purpose of tongues, a public utterance in tongues is a sign to unbelievers, whether unsaved people or Christians who have questions, discouragement, or doubt. Whereas they might easily discount or ignore a message in their own language, the miraculous utterance confronts them with the supernatural, and they must decide in that moment, is this message a fake or is this a miracle from God? If the latter, what does God want me to do? The utterance in tongues arrests the attention of the unbeliever so that he will more seriously consider the interpretation that is then to follow. Prophecy, on the other hand, primarily benefits believers, those who are saved or who at least acknowledge the supernatural. They do not need tongues to convince them to believe the miraculous and to listen to God's message, although public tongues can still be an encouragement and a confirmation to them. Let's look at verse 23 through 25. If therefore the whole church comes together and all speak in tongues, and outsiders or unbelievers enter, will they not say that you are out of your minds? But if all prophecy and an unbeliever or outsider enters, he is convicted by all, he is called to account by all, the secrets of his heart are disclosed, and so, falling on his face, he will worship God and declare that God is really among you. Isn't that awesome? Verse 23 through 25 make the direction, or the direct application rather, to public services when it says the whole church comes together in one place. Tongues without interpretation do not benefit the unbeliever or untaught person who attends. If everyone speaks in personal devotional tongues throughout a public service, the unbeliever who is present does not learn anything but thinks everyone is crazy. That's what it's saying, right? If all we did, the whole service, was speak in tongues, you think that'd be confusing to a new believer? Absolutely. But preaching, testimony, or the gift of prophecy in the known language will convict the unbeliever, reveal the secrets of his heart, and lead him to repentance and worship. Here we see the importance of using spiritual gifts to bless others and specifically to reach the lost. And at first glance, verses 23 through 25 may appear to contradict verse 22, but they do not. Verse 22 speaks of the sign value of a public utterance in tongues that is followed by an interpretation. The utterance in tongues gets the unbeliever's attention, and then the interpretation instructs him. So verses 23 through 25 contrast private devotional tongues with prophecy, showing that the former are not profitable when they dominate a public service, but the latter is. Verse 22 explains the valid purpose of tongues functioning as a sign to unbelievers when used properly in a service, while verse 23 explains the detriment of tongues confusing unbelievers when not used properly. Okay, moving on to verses 27 through 31. If any speak in a tongue, let there be only two or at most three, and each in turn, and let someone interpret. But if there is no one to interpret, let each of them keep silent in church and speak to himself and to God. Verse 29, let two or three prophets speak, and let the others weigh what is said. Verse 30, if a revelation is made to another sitting there, let the first be silent, for you can all prophesy one by one so that all may learn and all be encouraged. In other words, don't overlap each other. If one's speaking a prophetic word, someone else doesn't need to be trying to speak it at the same time. So here we find practical guidelines for church meetings to ensure that the vocal spiritual gifts are exercised for the edification of an entire audience. Okay? So here we go. This is the moment some of you have been waiting for. Practical guidelines, okay? First of all, it says in one meeting, allow two or at most three public utterances in tongues, which is addressing the entire audience. That's verse 27. While speaking in tongues is a notable sign to the unbeliever, three such utterances are adequate to demonstrate God's miraculous power and to establish the sign. Further utterances add little value at all and could become then only a distraction from what's already happened or taken place in that service. Okay? After a public utterance in tongues, wait for an interpretation. It's verse 27. Otherwise, the tongue does not benefit the audience. If no interpretation is forthcoming, if there's no interpretation, there's tongues that goes forth, and there's no interpretation, the speaker should then be quiet, verse 28. They should not continue to address the audience in tongues, like continuing to try. It didn't take the first time, so I'm going to try it again. Okay, that's what it's saying. You should then be quiet. He should not commit or continue to address the audience in tongues, for he is not benefiting them, but he can continue to pray quietly in tongues for their own benefit. Okay? In one meeting, allow two or at most three public prophecy, supernatural utterances in the known tongue to the entire audience. That's verse 29. And this amount is very much sufficient to communicate God's message for the occasion. Usually there's going to be tongues and interpretations. Sometimes there will be a second, but then there's going to be a word. Boom. Okay? And usually that is good enough. All right? This happened before where there's tongues and interpretation. An interpretation goes forth, and you don't need to start trying to speak in another tongue or give another utterance in tongues while that prophecy or that word of interpretation is going forth. You need to be silent and hear what God is speaking through that vessel to interpret that tongue that had already gone forth, that utterance. Make sense? Does it make sense? Okay, because if not, I can keep going. This amount is sufficient, all right? Okay, another thing the listener should evaluate, and this is scripture, verse 30. The listener should evaluate all prophetic utterances. While God is infallible, no human being is. Therefore, any utterance from a human could be wholly or partially erroneous. As we discussed previously, each listener has the responsibility to discern whether a prophecy is from God, and if so, how does it apply to my life? Okay? In this context, to judge does not mean to find fault, to condemn, or object publicly. It simply means to evaluate the validity and relevance of the message that you just heard. All right? If speaker and listener are both filled with and motivated by the Holy Spirit, then the spirit within the listener will bear witness that he has or she has indeed heard a message from the Lord. If there is no such witness, the listener should consider whether they have been sensitive to the Spirit and whether they have felt what the rest of the church has felt. Because if the majority of the church is like, woo, hallelujah, amen, that was a word from God, and they're responding, but you're like, what just happened? I didn't think that was a word from God. Well, maybe you need to pray and say, God, help me to discern my human spirits at work right now. And I need to check it, okay? And I need to listen a little bit more closely to thus saith the Lord. That happens. It does. All right? So if the speaker and listener are both filled with this and motivated by the Spirit within the listener will bear witness that he has indeed heard a message from the Lord. If there is no such witness, the listener should consider, am I being sensitive to what God's doing? Or if the rest of the church is kind of where you're at, maybe it's not a word from the Lord. Okay, that happens sometimes. All right, it does. It doesn't mean that person is the devil that missed it. Okay? Doesn't mean they're living in grave sin. Okay? We that can happen. Sometimes we think, okay, this I'm going to respond to this, and we step out in faith, and it's not quite there. It's okay. It takes practice, honestly, just like a muscle. Spiritual discernment is somewhat subjective, but the written word is objective. If an utterance contradicts the Bible, we must always follow the Bible. If an utterance contradicts the Word of God, follow the Word of God. Follow the Bible. Follow the Word of God. Always. Okay? Let's see. I'm good on time. If there is more than one prophecy, the speakers should take turns, verses 30 through 31. They should not vie for attention. I gotta hurry. After one person has prophesied and it is evident that a second person also has a prophecy, the first person should stop and let the other person continue. The body is blessed most when everyone has that opportunity that is feeling that opportunity, okay? Of course, from the previous guidelines, we learn that not everyone will be able to speak, okay, in one service. Praise God. In the book of Acts 2, we got to recognize these were smaller settings for the most part, okay? And so most of the time, there would be multiple people given an opportunity if they had a prophetic word. I am not going to let everybody that feels like they have a word from God in each service, we would never get out of here, and y'all wouldn't have an Easter Sunday, okay, this to go eat and enjoy after church. So it was a little different, but it's still the same principle, right? When verse 27 says, let one interpret, it simply means let someone interpret. There is no requirement that if one person speaks in tongues, a different person must interpret. For verse 13 instructs the speaker to pray that he may interpret, right? Nor does verse 27 mean that only one person may interpret multiple utterances in tongues. Okay, let's keep going. Verse 32, and the spirits of prophets are subject to prophets. For God is not a God of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. Verse 32 affirms that we can abide by the foregoing rules, and verse 33 explains why these rules are necessary. As we discuss, when God gives us a gift, he does not eliminate our human will or override our freedom of choice. The gift is subject to proper use or misuse, and it is our responsibility to use it properly. That's why you don't need to use these gifts flippantly, okay? You need to be prayerful and sensitive and in tune to what's happening, what God is speaking. If someone prays fervently until he speaks in tongues, God will not stop that utterance just because the circumstances are not appropriate. The speaker must regulate. The speaker must regulate it according to the principles of God's word. The one speaking in tongues must be sensitive. It's what it's saying there. Is this the time where I need to be bolting out in tongues right now? Okay? When they do so, they do not quench the spirit, but make proper use of the gift and the choice God has given them. Don't let your emotions get out of control. I got to keep going. Let us suppose God gives someone a prophetic message, right? The individual still must decide if the message is exclusively for their benefit, for another individual, or for the whole church. He must also decide when is the appropriate time to give it. Even when he correctly discerns God's purpose and timing, he must cooperate with the spiritual leadership of the church so as not to cause disruption or confusion. If I, the pastor, am up here trying to give instruction, you don't need to be trying to give somebody else instruction in this altar or in that seat. I'm going to say it again. When the spiritual authority of this body is up here trying to give instruction to this body, you stop what you're doing, let the voice of instruction be given, and then you may proceed if you discern that you need to proceed. All right. Just want us all to be in agreement there. Because if not, I can keep going on that too. Okay? In every church, God is more interested in peace, unity, cooperation, and mutual submission than in the exact time and delivery of a certain prophecy. God can accomplish the purpose of a prophecy in many ways and times and through various people, but he never approves of disorder, contention, or rebellion. Thus, the speaker of a prophecy can and must learn to control his own spirit so that he speaks in the manner and time that will edify the body. All right? 754. Whew. Skipping down to verse 39 through 40. So my brothers earnestly desire to prophesy and do not forbid speaking in tongues. But all things should be done decently and in order. So there it is. Again, he's not saying you can't speak in tongues, but you need to make sure that while you're speaking in tongues that you're not bringing confusion to the body, okay? If you're so loud, people are going to think, oh, it's time to stop. God's speaking, and then there's going to come an interpretation, all right? We got to be careful and discern that and be sensitive to that. Verses 39 through 40 summarize the teaching of the chapter, providing in a nutshell the solution to the problem of disruption in the Corinthian church. The Corinthians were not lacking in spiritual gifts and manifestations, but as we see throughout the epistle, they were lacking in maturity and unity. For example, 1 Corinthians 1, 10 through 13, 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 4. So the most important spiritual manifestations they needed were prophecies, which were understandable messages to the whole church that would strengthen the body. Instead of additional individual manifestations, they needed gifts that would enhance unity and lead to a maturity characterized by concern and consideration for one another. And here we find an important principle of general application. In corporate meetings, in addition to worshiping God and our primary goals, it must be to hear from God and to minister one to another. We need to pray for God to speak to us collectively through prophecy in every sense of the word, anointed preaching, teaching, and testimony, as well as supernatural utterances directly from God in the local language. We also need tongues with interpretation, which together provide the same benefit as prophecy. While emphasizing the most needed gifts in public worship, Paul, unlike many commentators today, did not disparage or discourage any spiritual gift. In trying to bring order to chaotic services, Paul did not want anyone to conclude that he opposed gifts such as tongues. He did not want anyone, however, to misconstrue or misapply his instructions so as to forbid public utterances in tongues, whether in theory or in practice. He simply wanted to make sure that all public utterances were for the benefit of everybody. And finally, whatever we do in public worship, it should be decent and in order. That's what he said. We should not allow confusion and chaos and rebellion or selfishness, but everything we do should be for the good of the body. Each of us has a responsibility to fulfill this admonition in our local church. And the pastor, and I'm not just saying this because I'm the one up here and I'm the pastor, but the pastor is ultimately responsible to guide the church correctly as these things start happening, and that's exactly why I'm teaching you about it. Typically, disorderly situations can be handled tactfully by promoting group worship, by changing the order of something that's happening, or if need be, by speaking a few words of public or private instruction. Okay? On rare occasions, a public pastoral rebuke is necessary to counteract a demonic or carnal influence that seeks to dominate, dictate, control, distract what God is doing in a service. Okay? The responsibility of each member is to follow the guidelines that have been given to us through Scripture, to be sensitive to the Spirit, and to follow the direction of the pastor and or the service leader. A mature congregation can overcome any negative spiritual influences, unite together, see God's gifts, the gifts of the Spirit at work in His body, and see great miracle signs and wonders and victory in the church. And isn't that what we want? Why don't we stand and why don't we pray and let's ask God for it as we are about to be dismissed. Lord Jesus, we thank You for Your word. We thank You for, Lord, this privilege and opportunity, God, to be a part of Your church. And we want to do things, Lord, in the right order. And Lord Jesus, with